For coming and leading us in worship, and special thanks, Carla, for you for working and practicing on that. That's one of my favorite songs right now, literally. And so if there's one perk to being the pastor, I got to make a special request, and so they put that into the set this week, and love it. Did a great job, Carla. Thank you for doing that today. We are doing this series. Well, first of all, let me just wrap up the last 2 weeks. We left here on Monday. Got to go see Austin for a week, and he misses all of you guys tremendously. Just know that. He would love to be back here in Warner Robins and in the Vine, but he's learning a lot this year as he's a intern at a church up there in youth ministry. They just went to camp last week. They were doing VBS the week we were there, and so that was good. And as most of you know, Austin, he was up to do some stupid stuff on stage and all that, so he's fitting right in with that part. And then we went there and we left there and went and saw my dad, who, as you guys know and are praying for, has prostate cancer. Still keep praying, he still has it. He's actually, they're now trying to send him one of two places, either to University of Virginia for one procedure or to Johns Hopkins for another procedure. And so he's supposed to go the 18th. So please just keep praying for him and that, and doctors and nurses and all in that regard. For that, I got to go see Monica's folks in Charlotte as we headed back here, then got here back yesterday. So it's been a great 2 weeks, but I can honestly say that I miss you guys. When I'm not here, I miss you guys. I know some pastors take like a whole month off, and I'm not really sure how they do that. I'm not sure if I can make it a whole month without seeing you guys, but I'm glad to be back today. I appreciate Brandon coming last week and preaching. He's a great young man, great young family, and I'd love to have him come and fill in when I'm going to be away. But we are in week 3 of a 6-week series called Small Book, Big Message. By the end of the summer, we're going to have covered 6 of the books that are called minor prophets in the Old Testament. They're called minor prophets in some regard because they're not the well-known prophets. They're not Daniel and Isaiah and those guys that you've heard a lot about. Jonah is probably the most famous of the minor prophets, and you know him because of a whale. And so last week, I know Brandon talked about the book of Jonah. So we started off in week 1 talking about Hosea, and it was pretty awesome to me, I hope it was to you, to look through the book of Hosea and see the story of redemption. The story of redemption when Hosea went to redeem Gomer, when he had to go pay for his wife back, the redemption there. And then Jesus used that, or God used that as a picture of Israel, and how many times they had been unfaithful to God, and God had gone and redeemed them back from the Egyptians, redeemed them back from the Babylonians, and those kinds of things. And so, and then even to see our redemption story, how many times have we been unfaithful to Christ, and yet he redeemed us, he bought us back. And so that was the book of Hosea, and you can feel free to read that if you want to. It's a great, great small book. And then last week, I know Brandon did Jonah. I've not watched it yet, but I'm sure he did a great job of just talking about that. And I'm sure all you guys who love fishing were really into that story. So because I know every fish you catch is a whale, right? Right? It doesn't start out as a whale, but by the time you get done with it, it was a whale. So I'm sure that a lot of you enjoyed that. But today we're going to look at the book of Habakkuk. Yes, there's a book in the Bible called Habakkuk. He was a minor prophet. Again, minor because not many of us have heard about it. If you go to find it in your Bible, you're going to see it's only 2 or 3 pages. But it has a very, very powerful message in it for us today. In fact, I might would say, and I probably shouldn't say this yet, but it may be one of the most powerful of the 6 books that we're going to look at as it applies to our lives today. So Habakkuk, Chapter 1, if you have your Bibles, you can open to there. It's after Nahum. Yeah, that's in the Bible too. It's after Nahum. But if you don't have your Bible, that's okay because the verses should be up behind me, all except for the last few. In fact, Blake, will you go in the media room and get my cell phone? Because there's a verse on there I want to read later. I was supposed to keep that in my pocket. Let's just see. Where's it at? So you got it, Colby? Awesome. Awesome. Thank you, son. Habakkuk chapter 1, let me just first just get into by reading these first four verses. It says in the, bring me my phone. I can't read it from back there. I saw you going.
Where are we going?
Well, I'm not reading these verses from here. I'm just reading a verse in a minute from here. There you go. Habakkuk chapter 1, it says, this is the message that the prophet Habakkuk received in a vision. How long, O Lord, must I cry for help? This is what Habakkuk is saying to God. How long, O Lord, must I cry for help, but you do not listen? Violence is everywhere I cry, but you do not come to save. Must I forever see these evil deeds? Why must I watch all the misery wherever I look? I see destruction and violence. I am surrounded by people who love to argue and fight. The law has become paralyzed, and there is no justice in the courts. The wicked far outnumber the righteous, so that justice has become perverted. We see in the book of Habakkuk two questions that he asked the Lord. And here's the first one. And in verse 2, he says, how long must I wait? Now, as we read there in those first four verses, Habakkuk is crying out to God. This isn't a casual conversation. This isn't just a happy-go-lucky, sit-down-to-dinner type of conversation. He is crying out to God. And in this, what he's crying out to, he's crying out to God as the creator, God as the judge, and he sees all this wickedness on earth. He sees all this wickedness with the people of Israel. And he says, how long must I wait for you to come and do justice on all of this evil? All of this evil. He talks about violence. He talks about misery. He talks about destruction. He talks about he's surrounded by people who love to argue and fight. He says the law has become paralyzed and there's no justice in our courts. And he says, how long must I wait? He's wondering why God is not acting immediately, why God right now is not executing judgment, why God is not putting these people, why is he not taking the wicked and destroying them? And he's wondering, how long must I wait? Now let me ask you a question. How have you ever asked God, how long must I wait? I imagine many of us have said, God, how long must I wait? God, I've been praying for this. I've been praying for a special person in my life. I've been praying for children in my life. I've been praying for a job promotion. I've been praying for a job. I've been praying for this. I've been praying for that. And we get to the point of saying, God, how long must I wait until you answer? You see, can I stop right here and just say something? God is not scared of your questions. There's not a question you would want to ask God that he's scared of. He's not sitting up in heaven going, they can ask me anything, but I hope they don't ask me that. They could say anything, but I hope they don't ask me about this. I hope he is not scared of our questions. As a loving father, he invites our questions. He would much rather have you come and just ask him, God, how long must I wait? God, how long must I wait for that job? God, how long must I wait for a spouse? God, how long must I wait for that person? God, how long must I wait for my children to straighten out? God, how long must I wait? He would much rather you have come to him as his heavenly father. When they ask God, how long must I wait? Than just to sit there and in your heart of hearts without praying to God, asking yourself that. It's okay to ask God, how long must I wait? In fact, and in this part of the story, we see that Habakkuk is on the side of right. He's saying, God, this is evil. This is wicked. He's saying, God, I'm on your side, but I can't do anything about it. But you can. How long must I wait? Now, here's the second question. We find it down a few verses later, verses 12 to 17. It says, O Lord my God, my Holy One, you are eternal. Surely you do not plan to wipe us out. O Lord, our rock, you have sent these Babylonians to correct us, to punish us for our sins, but you are pure and cannot stand the sight of evil. Will you wink at their treachery? Should you be silent while the wicked swallow up people more righteous than they are? Are we only fish to be caught and killed? Are we only sea creatures that have no leader? Must we be strung up by their hooks and caught in their nets while they rejoice and celebrate? Then they will worship their nets and burn incense in front of them. These nets are the gods who have made us rich, they will claim. Will you let them get away with this forever? Will they succeed forever in their heartless conquest? Here's the second question he asked. How long must you be silent? God, not only how long do I have to wait, but God, how long will you be silent? Have you ever went to God with a prayer request and you just didn't get the answer right away? Like you didn't just say amen and open your eyes and there was the answer to your request? And sometimes if you do that long enough about something important enough to you, you'll begin to ask yourself, God, are you even hearing me? God, are you hearing me and ignoring me? Are you hearing me? God, what are you doing? Where are you at in this? God, I'm coming to you. And again, I go back. Habakkuk is crying out to God. This is not just a casual conversation. He is aching to know what God's going to do. So how long will you be silent? Have you ever asked yourself that? Have you ever asked yourself, God, how long must I wait? And have you ever asked yourself, how long will you be silent? Can I say this to you? If you've never asked yourself that question, chances are at some point in your life, you will. And for those of you in here today who have already asked yourself those questions, you know exactly what I'm talking about with Habakkuk. And so today I want to talk, and I just want to make a few quick points about what it means to wait on the Lord. What it means to wait on the Lord. Write this down. This isn't one of the notes, I don't think, but it's just a thought I had when I was putting this together. It says, we may be fully in the center of God's will, and yet we may not be comfortable with God's pace. There are things in our lives that we can do that are dead center of God's will. We don't even have to question if it's God's will for us. We don't have to make a thing. But sometimes the pace that God works at is different from our pace. Let me give you an example. The Bible says, go and make disciples, right? Tell everybody about me everywhere you go, right? And so we could meet here for the next 8 Saturdays as a church. And all of you could come, and even the ones that are on vacation this week, they all come. And so we have 120, 30, 40, 50 people. And we go out and we knock on every door in Perry. And we invite them to come to church. And we tell them about Christ. And yet we come back and we gather together. We all say, well, nobody responded. Nobody said yes. Nobody said they'd come. You see, sometimes we can be dead center of God's will, and yet God may be working at a different pace than we're working at. So what does it mean to wait on the Lord? And how do you wait on the Lord? There are going to be those times in your life, and the chances are the younger you are, the more of these that are waiting for you out in your life. Those of us who are a little bit older have experienced some of these moments, and so we know what's happening here, but there's going to be those times when you're going to have to wait on God. So what do you do? What do you do? 3 quick things, and what do? The first thing you do is you trust in His Word. Trust in His Word. This Bible has been given to us. This Scripture has been given to us. This is God's Word to us. Isn't it amazing? For those of you that read your Bible regularly, isn't it amazing how many times you could just pick the Bible up and read a verse and it applies to your life today in 2018? Isn't it amazing that the Bible isn't outdated, that the Bible hasn't run out of illustrations that are applicable? I mean, we read the story of Hosea and Gomer. I mean, that could be any day in USA. So as we read this, we need to realize that 2 Timothy 3:16 says, God's Word is inspired by God Himself. God Himself has inspired the writers. They have written down the things that God has told them. And so what does the Bible say? Well, it says a lot. Jeremiah 29:11, He says, I know the plans I have for you. You know, maybe you're a young college student. I know Austin's dealing with this right now. And maybe you're high school, college, and you're trying to figure out, what am I supposed to do with my life? My parents have made it clear one of the things I'm supposed to do with my life is move out at some point. But what am I supposed to do? How am I going to earn money? How am I going to make that happen? God says, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Matthew 11:28, he says, Jesus said, I will give you rest. How many times are we trying to find rest in all sorts of things, and yet Jesus says, I will give you rest. Isaiah 40:31 says, those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. How many of you are out there today trying to do things in your own strength, trying to make it happen in your own power? And yet the Word of God that we're supposed to trust and rely on says, put our trust in the Lord. I've known people who have done that for years at a time. Try to knock down a door to a promotion, try to knock down, you know, getting into a certain company and all that. And they try all sorts of things. And yet our trust is to be in God. Philippians 4:19, the Scriptures tell us that God will supply all of my needs. All of my needs. God will supply all of my needs. Romans 8:38 says nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Now let me just tell you, a lot of us battle with that, right? You go throughout the week and there's a lot of things that try to separate you from the love of God. Some of your jobs try to separate you from the love of God. Some of your money management things try to separate you from the love of God. Some of our eating habits try to separate us from the love of God, because we do those things that we know aren't necessarily right. And in our ears, this little chirping voice called Satan, and he just tells us over and over, God couldn't love you because of that. God couldn't love you because you did that. God doesn't love you because you don't eat right, you don't look right, you don't dress right. God doesn't love you. And that little chirping voice is in your head all throughout the week, and yet the Scriptures tell us that nothing can separate you from the love of God. But you have to trust in that. You have to put your faith in that. You have to put your heart in that. You have to put your life into believing and trusting the Word of God, or you can spend your life listening to the chirping voice in your ear. We have to trust in the Word of God. And if you're going to trust in the Word of God, it would help to know the Word of God. So whether it's a daily devotion, whether it's a book that you're reading, whether it's literally just taking a book and say, I'm just going to read this book this week, or a proverb a day, or break it up however you want to. You can start reading a psalm a day and you'll finish 2 years from now. But just do whatever you want to do, but get the Word of God into your life, because you can't trust what you don't know. It's sad, but some people, this is the only Bible they're going to get all week. And it's not because they can't. Because when they come here and they say, all right, you're the preacher, you do it, you tell us about it. And then they go out there and live the rest of the week, and then come back next week going, tell us about some more. Guys, you have access to this. It's on your cell phone. Man, YouVersion. It's free. It's not even a 99-cent app. It's free. And yet, it's on our cell phones. It's never been more convenient to get to the Word of God, ever, than it is today. But so many of us don't know, and you can't trust in the Word of God if you don't know the Word of God. Here's the second thing. What to do when you're waiting on God? You have to have faith in His sovereignty. Faith in His sovereignty. Now, I know there's two words there that throw us off, so let me just define them. What does faith mean? Faith is believing in, even though you haven't seen yet. Believing in, even though you haven't seen it. Let me give you an illustration. How many of you came in this morning and drank coffee? It was free, right? So you how many, keep your hands up. Quite a few. All right, so right, it's okay. Some of you are like, you're ashamed. Like, I didn't ask if you had three cups. I just said, did you have a cup of coffee? Now, not one of you saw who made that coffee. Not one of you saw who put the water in it. Did they use the filters, the right scoops? And yet you walked right back there and threw it under there, and then you threw your special sauce in it, and then you've been drinking it all, enjoying it, right? That's faith. You didn't even know you had faith, but you had faith. You had faith. I made it, so you had faith in me. And I don't drink coffee, so you really had a lot of faith. All of you, every single one of you, came in here today and sat in that seat, and not one of you tested it out. You didn't check, make sure everything was, you know, fastened correctly. You just plopped down. That's faith. Well, we have to have faith in God's sovereignty. What's that word sovereignty mean? That's a big, big word. I remember when I was first in college in my theology class, that word came out, and I had no clue what it meant. And sad to say, my professor did not help me understand it much anymore because he was talking way up here, and I'm like, brother, you need to bring it way down here. It basically says this, God's sovereignty is he knows everything. He knows everything. He knows the beginning to the end, everything. He knows creation to the new heaven and new earth. He knows from sin to salvation. He knows the hairs on your head. He knows the sorrows in your heart. He knows the pain in your lives. He knows your needs. He knows your wants. He knows your desires. He knows every second of your life. That's his sovereignty. He knows it all. We have to have faith in his sovereignty. When we were up in Virginia, we visited with lots of friends that we had at a church I served, we served at up in Chesapeake. And, I mean, this was now 15 years ago, and we were there for 6 years, so 20 years ago we went there. 21 years ago. Austin was 6 months old when we went there. And none of us 20 years ago could have predicted where our lives would be today. Our friends couldn't have predicted where their lives would be today. The people in that church could not have predicted where their lives would be today. Monica and I and Austin and Blake could not have predicted where our lives would be 20 years later. But you know who could, who did, and who knows? God knows. God knew 20 years ago that I would be standing here today preaching on the book of Habakkuk. God knew 15 years ago that he was going to move us to Georgia. God knew 12 years ago, long ago, long before 12 years ago, that we would plant a church called The Vine. God knew long before time that you would be sitting here today. That's his sovereignty. He knows us. He knows it all. You think you're hiding something from God? You're not hiding anything from God. He knows it all. And we have to put our faith and our trust in the reality that he loves us. And cares for us and watches over us. So when you're waiting on the God, when you're waiting on the Lord, when he seems silent, man, you've got that prayer request and you're just praying about it and praying about it and praying about it, and you're not seeing the answer, you just need to know that God knows. So you may be praying about something that's for the immediate, for right now, but God knows, hey, 5 years from now, that's not going to be a good decision. So you have to trust in his sovereignty. And here's the third thing. We have to find security in his arms. Find security in his arms. He is our protector. And so we have to find security in his arms. John 10:28 tells us that no one can snatch us out of the hands of God. No one can snatch us out of the hands of God. Excuse me. And so as you're waiting on the Lord, as you're praying to him, as you're crying out to him, maybe as Habakkuk was crying out to him, you need to understand that your security comes in his arms. He's your protector. You remember the image that he gives us in the scriptures of us being like a little bird under a cliff, and he takes his wing, like a big eagle wing, and he takes that big wing and covers us and protects us? That's where we find our security. And so when you're waiting on God, when he seems silent, you need to realize he's right there. He's never left you. He's right there. He's protecting you. Well, God answers Habakkuk to both of his questions. And there's something interesting about God's answers back to Habakkuk. In verse 5 and verse 6, you remember verse 2, he said, "How long must I cry out for help? But you won't listen." Well, look at verse 5 or 6. It said, "The Lord replied, 'Look around at the nations, look and be amazed, for I am doing something in your own day, something you wouldn't believe, even if someone told you about it. I am raising up the Babylonians, a cruel and violent people, and they will march across the world and conquer other lands.'" Here's what's interesting about that. Habakkuk is praying because of the evilness of the Israelites. Habakkuk's crying out because the Israelites are doing evil. He says, "God, I want you to stop them. I want you to be just and execute justice." And God says, "I'm doing it right now. I'm raising up these Babylonians, And they're going to come across, and they're going to not only take over Israel, they're going to take over many nations. And here's what's interesting about it. The Babylonians were far more wicked than the Israelites. They were meaner, they were crueler, they were uglier, they worshipped more gods, they were more violent in their army and their executions and all of that. They were more horrible than Israel. And it's almost like Habakkuk was like, God, I want you to do something, but then it was like, God, I don't want you to do that. Like, that's a little over the top, God. I just want you to maybe a little rain or, I don't know, but God, don't raise that up. That's going to be far worse than I ever anticipated. And then in verse chapter 2, we see him answer his second question. Chapter 2, he says this in verse 2. He says, "Then the Lord said to me, 'Write my answer plainly on tablets so that a runner can carry to collect messages to carry the correct messages to others.' This vision is for a future time. It describes the end. It will be fulfilled. If it seems slow in coming, wait patiently, for it will surely take place. It will not be delayed." You see, God is always at work. Even when he seems silent, he's at work. And so the question for us today, or the question for you, maybe you are in that mode of, you've been asking God about something, you've been crying out to God for something, and it doesn't seem like he's answered yet. The reality is, we need to realize that God is for us. When you know that God is for you, you don't have to question what's happening or what's going on. It's only when you doubt that God is for you. And to be quite honest with you, that's one of the things that Satan just chirps in your ear about, is God for me? There's a song out on the radio. It actually played on the way to church today. It plays a lot. It's real popular. It talks about, I want the healer instead of the healing. I want the giver instead of the giving. And basically the point of that song is, I want God more than what God can do for me. I want to be invested in God. I want to love God more than just he's my bank account, more than he's my ultimate boss at my job, more than any other question or desire I may have. That I want God himself versus what all God can do for me. And in Habakkuk chapter 3, I want you to hear this. It says, "Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails, and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior." You see, so many of us, we have a consumer mentality. I want God, but what can God do for me? I want a relationship with Jesus, but that means I get to go to him and tell him, I want this, I want that, I want it. I mean, it's like sitting on Santa's lap. And yet, the deal for us is, we really should want God himself, in spite of whatever he could do for us. Habakkuk saw this injustice. He saw this wickedness. He saw this evil playing out in front of him. And he said, God, please do something. And then when God said, I'm doing something. And he was like, whoa, whoa, whoa. We don't know, God. That's too hard. No, whoa. Folks, realize that when you're waiting on God, he's at work. When you feel like you're not hearing from God, he's still speaking. When you have something and you're crying out to him about, he knows and he hears. Your faith and your trust need to be in him and be in his word, be in who he is, be in his security and his plan and his protection for us. So maybe you're here today and you're that person. You're in that spot. I can tell you from experience and from the past that I know exactly what that's like. I can remember a period of time not too long ago. For a couple of years, I was asking God this one question over and over and over and over. To the point I was crying out to God. Just one question. I was crying out to God for about 2 years. And just saying, God, when? God, why? God, how? God, what? For 2 years. So I know what it's like to be in that thing of you're waiting on God, and you got to be patient, but you don't want to be patient. Sometimes you even see the answer, but it's not the answer. Maybe you're here today and you're in that period of time. You're in that period of life right now, and there's something and you're praying about it. And you're having to wait on God. You're having to trust in God. You may even say to yourself, He's silent. He's not talking to me. He's not speaking to me. In just a moment, we're going to pray. And when we pray, as always, the front is open for prayer. And if you want to come and just pray and lift that up to Him, you can feel free to do that. God's not scared of your questions. He is not scared. He has a love and a care for us that we can't really earthly imagine. But in those moments when we're waiting and asking, and it seems like we're not hearing, the question is, are you willing to trust in His Word, trust in who He is, and trust in His protection and care for us? Let's pray.